Happy to introduce our today's speaker, Sergey Sinchuk from St. Petersburg University, and he is going to talk on the A1 homotopy groups of Chevalley groups.
Thank you, Lyosha. There's going to be three parts in my talk. I'm going to discuss pi 1, pi 0 before that, and after that, I'm going to present a new criterion for A1 invariance from our paper with Egor, Voronetsky, and Andrei, Lavrenov. But before proceeding to pi 1, let us talk a bit about pi 0 and the known results about pi 0. So I'm going to start with the following theorem due to Anastasia Stavrova, which says the following, that suppose that we have an isotropic algebraic group. So isotropic means that it contains at least one copy of, it contains split torus. And in this theorem, we require that it not only contains GM, but not split torus, but it contains at least two copies of GM in its torus.
And must usually say that she asks for this condition for every semi-simple octet or something like this.
Yeah. So, exactly. So, for example, if it is a product of two groups. So each copy should, each of these factors should contain GM of rank at least two. Okay, so this is what this condition that the isotropic rank of the group G is at least two. And so under these assumptions, she was able to compute this home set in the unstable A1 homotopy category over A. So this is unstable homotopy category not pointed over A. This home set can be computed as simply the K1 group modeled on the isotropic reductive group G. So another name in the literature for this thing is Whitehead group. And this is precisely the Whitehead group, which, for example, appears in the statement of Knezertis conjecture. So by definition, this K1G is simply the quotient of the groups of points of the group of points of G over A modulo the so-called elementary subgroup. So in the context of isotropic reductive group, it is defined in the following fashion. So we choose any parabolic subgroup which is defined over A. So since it is isotropic, there exists at least one. And take opposite unipotent radicals corresponding to this parabolic subgroup and span an abstract subgroup inside G. And the final result doesn't depend on the choice of P. And so this is what is called elementary subgroup in the context of isotropic reductive groups. And this whole quotient is called K1G. So a key ingredient in this proof is the following theorem, which states that this thing is A1 invariant. So it doesn't change when passing to the polynomial ring. This result is proved for regular rings over a field, and this, in some sense, is a computation parallel to the geometric case of Bass-Quillen conjecture. Because what does Bass-Quillen conjecture ask? It asks whether these two sets coincide. I mean, the set of constant rank n vector bundles over spectrum of A, and the same thing for A1 over A. And the original Lindell-Popescu result says that these two things coincide if A is a regular ring over a field. Of course, it has been generalized since the times of Lindell and Popescu to a much greater much larger class of rings. For example, there's a result due to Ashoko and Wendt, which establishes this equality and also this A1 invariance. And K is replaced, so it is no longer a field, but a regular Noetherian ring over a Dedekind domain with perfect residue fields. And for K0, so this leads to the following representability statement. So that this set of vector bundles can be interpreted as the home set in the unstable homotopy category, where instead of G, you have this infinite Grassmannian Frank N. So probably I have a little misprint here. It should be N rather than R. Ah, okay. So no questions so far. In my talk, I'm gonna be more interested in the very special case when this isotropic reductive group is not just isotropic, but actually split, and not just reductive, but actually simple Chevalley group. So here are the examples of Chevalley groups of simply connected type. So I should explain what does it mean for a group to be simply connected. So this this term simply connected means simply that it is constructed in a certain fashion. So Chevalley group is constructed out of a root system and the lattice, which is an intermediate lattice between the root lattice and the white lattice. And so simply connected type means that this lattice with which you construct the Chevalley group is the white lattice. So white is called simply connected because the complex points of these groups, so if you take the complex points and then consider it as a Lie group with the usual topology, then it will be simply connected in the usual topological sense. So both pi one and pi zero will be trivial of it. These groups are probably not simple as abstract groups, but if you quotient by the centers, they will be simple in the abstract sense. Okay, so why do we consider these groups? Just because this pi one computation will be the simplest for them. And it turns out that it is already not very trivial. So before we proceed with pi one, let us mention yet another theorem by Stavrova, which states that this K one object for Chevalley groups can be also computed in the non-geometric situation. So this is probably the simplest possible situation, which is not geometric, that we have a Dedekind domain. So it is stated in the theorem as let R be a local principal ideal domain. but Dedekind rings the local PIDs, so they they can be put into this theorem. The theorem works for them. And so the statement is that K1 is invariant for these rings. And this generalizes the result of Grunewald, Mennicke, and Wasserstein, which asserts practically the same thing, but only for the case of simple active groups, namely the case when the root system is of type CL. So well, this theorem is, illustrates that we can also do something not in the geometric case, but in greater generality. Okay. So now let us consider pi one of Chevalley groups. And probably a good thing to start with is this theorem of Völker and Wendt, which provides a computation of pi one of G for infinite fields. So this object pi one A one, so it is a pre-sheaf of groups, and so they compute one group in this pre-sheaf, namely they compute its value on K. And in terms of the unstable homotopy category, they compute this home set. Here S1 stands for the simplicial sphere, simplicial circle, I would say. And this is computation in the pointer category this time. And so the theorem states that this pi one group can be computed as pi one of the following simplicial group. So this simplicial group is obtained as follows. So we take this isotropic reductive group G. So G is, as in Stavrova's theorem, computed over on the simplicial resolution of K. So we get a simplicial group and we just then compute its pi one. And in the end, we get the following group, H2 of the elementary subgroup of G. So assumption on G is, as in Stavrova's theorem, isotropic rank is at least two. So in particular, if we substitute into this result, instead of an arbitrary isotropic reductive group, if we substitute the Chevalley group, we get the following. So we get either Milner K2 or Milner-Witt K2. This is just because this group has been computed in 1969 by Matsumoto. And these two groups show up in the answer. Of course, Matsumoto didn't know what K2 Milner-Witt is, but this is our modern understanding of his computation. So a subtlety here is that in the original statement of Völker and Wendt, here they write G of K, but I'm pretty sure that it should be replaced with EG of K. So, so I've just written here this for safety. So, because the values of an isotropic reductive group, even over a field, I mean, the group of points, it doesn't always coincide with the elementary subgroup. So any questions so far? Opa, я ничего не слышу.
Are there any assumptions on simply, I mean, simply connectedness assumptions here?
Okay. So in the second part, yes, probably it should be simply connected Chevalley group, yes. Because otherwise it will be just bigger. This group will be bigger. Okay.
Okay, and another question is, in this theorem, which equality is a difficult one?
So in this theorem,
I mean, the second one or the third one? I mean, the first one is the definition. And,
yeah, the first one is definition.
Yeah, which is difficult, the second or the third?
So the difficulty is this one. The second, I believe, this is some, this is where some general result in A1 homotopy theory is used. So I think this thing uses A1 homotopy theory, and this one doesn't. So this is just some computation with simplicial groups.
I mean, is it a classical one, or is it the thing that Bass-Quillen and Voronetsky did?
So what? So what does this equality use? So this is a difficult equality. So the key ingredient in the proof is the invariance result for the homology of isotropic reductive groups over fields. So there's a theorem of Matthias Wendt, which states that all the integral homology ring, not just H2, but all H for an isotropic group, they're invariant when passing to the polynomial extension. So this is the key ingredient.
May I ask about the second equality in the row? Is it weaker or stronger? So the statement that sing A1 construction of G is local, I mean, Nisnevich local. What is inside the parentheses of P1? It is G of delta dot. The statement that it is topologically local, Nisnevich local. It is stronger statement than this equality or what's the relation, and is it used, and is it true under this assumption?
I think this is more or less equivalent to this quality.
Yes, at least the quality should follow from this, but here it is written for points formally. And if it will be written for all, not spec k, but
but I am pretty sure that they use that it is you.
Mm-hmm. And so, local. And so the question is that this statement is correct under the assumptions of the theorem, the Nisnevich locality of the space is okay.
Yeah, I think it is proved in that paper by Wendt or you are. I mean.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I wanted to check this.
Okay, so the goal of our paper in turn is to obtain similar computation for Chevalley groups, but we will try to compute not the value of this pre-shift over k, but so we want to replace k with an arbitrary regular ring containing a field. So exactly the generality of Stavrova's first theorem, which I formulated before. Okay. So probably before we start doing that, it is actually useful to recall what happens in the classical topology. And so the answer, I've said earlier then that pi one of the complex Lie group is trivial of a simply connected Chevalley group, I mean. So let me write it on the left hand side of the blackboard. I claim that pi one of complex points with the usual complex topology is trivial. The real points, it is no longer trivial. But I suspect that the answer is actually very similar to Matsumoto's theorem, that we get either Z if phi is symplectic. By this I mean that it is either A1, B2, which is the same thing as C2, or C of rank at least 3. So this is what I mean by the root system to be of symplectic type. Otherwise, it is Z mod 2. So so I'm trying to write this right here. This answer right here, it looks to me very similar to the computation of the unstable Kato group, but over Z. So for some reason, this answer looks very much like the computation of the unstable K2 over Z. I'm actually not very much sure in this equality because I can compute this group K2 phi z in some cases, not for all phi, but in the cases when I can compute this, the answer is as written here. So probably there is some deep reason why these two computations agree. And
is this group already stable?
No, all these computations are unstable.
No, I mean, if you compute it over Z, then Z of dimension 1, and then if Z is at least rank, I don't know, 2 or something like that, is it already stable? Or?
Well, these two answers, they coincide with the stable groups. So the answers for stable groups, they agree with these things. Okay, so that was an explanation why not an explanation, but some bit of classical algebraic topology. Okay, so let us proceed. I have formulated our goal. So let us attempt to obtain these computations. We start with the following results. So recall that a pre-shift is called A1 naive if this home set can be computed in terms of the singular resolution for an affine smooth scheme X. And Ashoka event paper, so it gives a sufficient condition for a group scheme to be A1 naive. So it says the following, that H1 nis should be A invariant on smooth affine schemes. So if we can prove this, then we have this equality. And it turns out that this H1 nis shift is indeed A1 invariant. So this is called Sergey-Sinchuk conjecture. And it is proved not for Chevalley groups, but in much greater generality for isotropic reductive groups. If you want to fulfill our goal, we are left with computing pi one of this simplicial group. By the way, this thing is called in the literature the Karubi-Villiamayer K2 functor associated to the scheme G. So this is just some definition which you can find in Jardin's paper, for example. I mean, in Jardin's master thesis, I mean. Okay, I'll now try to compute this simplicial pi one. So in order to do that, I write starting portion of this simplicial set. I write only boundaries, I suppose they're called boundaries. So I write what is A of delta 2, A of delta 1, and what is A of delta 0. So they're defined by these qualities. And these boundaries, they're in turn given by this formula. Yes, this is called standard simplicial ring object. And it also appears in this old Jardin's paper. So I've tried to explain what this thing A delta is, but probably not for the experts who already know this stuff. So in order to go into the details, we need a couple more definitions. So first of all, I define the elementary subgroup for Chevalley groups. This definition agrees with the previous one for isotropic reductive groups, but it is actually much simpler. You can actually write the set of generators which doesn't depend on any parabolic subgroup. You can just write some generators which look like the usual transfections. And it turns out that this is a normal subgroup of the Chevalley group. So this is called Soslin-Tadei's theorem. And there is also an abstract group defined by generators and relations, which is called a Steinberg group, which is a central extension of this elementary subgroup. So the fact that it is a central extension is not trivial, actually. So this is a recent result with also with Andrei and Egor. So what is this thing? So it is defined in terms of generators modeling these transfections and the following two identities. So one of them simply says that X alpha are more like exponents, yeah? So they turn sum into the product. And this formula, it allows you to compute the commutator on these two elementary root unipotents of these two generators if these two roots are not opposite. So this is the result. It looks a little bit intimidating, but for the simply laced root system, the answer is much simpler. So there's only one term on the right-hand side if A plus B is a root, or there are actually no terms if it is not a root and not zero. And so there's an exact sequence. So there's a canonical map which sends each of these formal generators to the elementary root unipotent. So its image is by definition is the elementary subgroup. It is a normal subgroup. So we can consider the quotient by this subgroup, and this thing is called K1, which agrees with our previous definition. And the kernel is called K2. And this notation, for example, so this notation has appeared in an old paper of Mike Stein, and actually I'm going to compute pi1 of a Chevalley group. And in the end, I want to get this K2 as an answer. So the first fact which I would like to formulate is the following, that these two simplicial groups E and the ST, they are connected as simplicial groups. And moreover, if rank is at least two, then Steinberg group is simply connected as a simplicial group. Well, do we really want to see the proof? Because it is a very formal and technical computation with simplicial groups. But let me prove at least the first statement that it is connected, because it is probably very simple. So what should we prove? We should prove that okay, so consider this sequence. So this is called normalized Moore complex. And there is a theorem which says that the kth homotopy group of this of a simplicial group can be computed in terms of homology of this Moore complex. And so this this Moore complex is composed of intersection of kernels of almost all differentials except kernels of all the boundary maps except the zero one. And this zero one, they appear here as the differential maps in this complex. Okay, so if you substitute into this formula, for example, k equal to zero, then you get that it is all of G zero, which in our case coincides with Steinberg group over R. Here it is only, so there is only one kernel in this intersection, and the D1. And here in N2, it is intersection of two kernels, D1 and D2. And the remaining boundary map is used in the definition of this differential. Okay, so how do we show that pi zero is trivial for these two simplicial groups? Well, simply look at the definition. And if you show that D1 is surjective, so if you show that this map is surjective, then we are done. And it is actually very easy to see that it is surjective because, well, we can, for every element of this standard group, we can find a pre-image. So that's all proof. The computation of pi one is a little bit more tricky because we actually need one non-trivial property of Steinberg group. So okay, let me try to explain it. So first of all we compute what is a kernel of this differential delta one. I mean of this differential. It is intersection of the following two kernels. And it is the same thing as the following kernel from the standard group over the polynomial ring to the product of a pair of standard groups over that ring. And we use some not obvious result about standard groups that they can use with direct products. And so if you know that this equality holds, so this is not obvious and probably not very natural for Steinberg group to have this property because it is not an algebraic group. It is a group given by generators and relations. Of course, for algebraic groups, we have such property. We have even a more general one, namely that they commute with finite limits. But for Steinberg groups, so they definitely do not commute with finite limits, but still we have this equality for them. I'll explain it in a minute. And so the morphism is given as follows. So we take an element of this group and compute it over one and over zero, and we get a pair of these elements of these standard groups. And of course, it can be interpreted also as follows. Using this equality, and we also can use Chinese remainder theorem to identify R times R with this quotient of the polynomial ring module, this ideal generated by one element T multiplied by T minus one. Uh, And so in the end, we get the following expression, and it is, we can find a generating set for it. And then we simply show that so in this term N2, there is a preimage for every generator of this subgroup. So I have written it here. Well, so it is not not completely trivial computation, but it is not very difficult. So the problem of proving A1 invariance of K2 is not here. So this is an easy part of the paper. Okay, so I've presented some arguments why pi zero of Steinberg group is trivial. So probably I have to say that this result, namely that Steinberg group commutes with direct product, so we are able to deduce this as a corollary of a recent paper of Vavilov and Zhang. So if you want to decompose a group into a direct product, you have to prove that the generators of these subgroups, that they commute with each other. And of course, it is obvious for all the generators of the form X alpha, A0, X beta, 0B, if these two roots are not opposite, but if they're opposite, then you have to actually do some computation if you want to prove that this commutator is trivial. And this computation has been performed in the paper of Vavilov and Zhang, and they show that these commutators of opposite pairs of roots, that they satisfy the following congruences, modulo certain subgroup, yes, which in our case is trivial. So we apply this result to the case when the base ring R is our product of R1 and R2. The ideals are like this, so the product is zero. So the group in the right-hand side is the same as TFR, so the kernel is trivial. So these congruences turn into equalities, and if you substitute C into these formulas, you'll get that these commutators are always trivial, and so that's what gives the desired decomposition of this Steinberg group into a direct product, and that's what we have used in the computation before. Well, probably I explained it a little bit sloppily, but if you have questions, I can attempt to answer them nevertheless. So no questions, right?
I have a little bit related, probably a related question. Do you know anything about A1 invariance of homology of Steinberg group?
I don't know results like this. Probably you can show that. Well, all the results which I know, they are for the homology of groups of points, but these groups of points are considered over a field. So I haven't seen anything about the homology of Steinberg groups studied separately. So if you do know anything, then you can.
Yeah, and that result by Matthews was over a field.
Yeah,
I mean, for elementary group.
Yes, yeah, so it was for isotropic reductive groups, but it only worked over a field. So And actually, you can add only one polynomial variable. You can't add the second one.
I mean, you can't. I mean, you mean that it fails to be invariant, or it is not null?
So I actually suspect that the way it is formulated, probably it's not true, because for groups of rank two, so that it is known that groups of rank two behave differently from groups of rank at least three, and that the groups of rank two, for them, there's no chance to prove A1 invariance for a greater number of variables than one. So, whether probably I forgot to mention that, but if you've asked, I can add a little clarification here. So, I've said that we want to obtain similar computation to the Sergey-Levin's theorem. So, but the tricky moment here is that their result works for all groups of rank at least two, but we only hope to obtain a similar result for group of rank at least three. And actually, the computations which we have at the moment, they work only for groups of rank at least four. But for groups of rank at least two, there can be no analogs of this result. So there are counterexamples to it. I mean, there are counterexamples to the A1 invariance. So you cannot prove that K2 is A1 invariant for groups of rank two. Okay. So yeah, so that was some computation with simplicial groups. Probably you've become tired attempting to listen to it. Okay. So
may I ask one question in this context about K2? Can you say about the generators for K2? It is not for the reasoning question about the reason, but just in this context, what is known? And the question is, what are parameters? If for parameters in the definition of the Steinberg group are in a fine line. And is it true that there exists some set of generators for K2 and these parameters in GM?
So the answer is that yes, it is known. So this is called Steinberg symbols. So in many cases, K2 is generated by Steinberg symbols. Not always. So I would say that the answer is pretty complicated. So sometimes it is generated by symbols. So for fields, it is surely generated by Steinberg symbols. Mm-hmm. For Z, it is also generated by Steinberg symbols. Then you might ask, what happens for Dedekind rings? It turns out that it is not just not generated by Steinberg symbols. It is also not always generated by Danny-Stein symbols, which are a generalization of Steinberg symbols. And so there are papers in number theory journals, which, for example, entitled examples showing that K2 is not generated by Danny-Stein, examples of a Dedekind ring for which K2 is not generated by Danny-Stein symbols. So the answer is not really beautiful and satisfactory from my point of view.
Mm-hmm.
So for some rings, it is known that they're generated by symbols. For others, it is known that such description cannot work. So, okay.
Thank you.
Anyway, so, now we can attempt to compute our simplicial pi one of a Chevalley group. By the way, at this point, no assumptions on the rank are actually used. So here, phi can be arbitrary of rank at least two. But as I've said, the final answer, it has no chance of working for phi of rank 2. So so what do? We just use the following simple technical tool called long exact sequence of groups associated to a short exact sequence of simplicial groups. So it looks just like the usual long exact sequence, but all the objects here are actually groups, and all these arrows are actually homomorphisms of groups. So these pi zeros are also groups, and so everything here is in the category of groups. So we just take these two short exact sequences of simplicial groups and just write these two portions of this long exact sequence. And so from the first one, using the fact that K1 is A1 invariant, so in particular, this means that the simplicial K1 is discrete. Just because, so this simplicial resolution, its terms are actually polynomial rings in disguise. So yeah, probably everybody knows that. And if K1 doesn't change when passing to the polynomial rings, then it must be discrete. So all these groups are trivial. And we have an isomorphism of pi1g with pi1 of e. And from the second exact sequence, we obtain the following isomorphism. So that's so yeah, here we use our computation of pi1 of Steinberg group, namely that it is trivial always. So we obtain that pi1 of E can be computed as pi zero of our simplicial K2. And so what do we get? We get that if you want to obtain that pi1 of this simplicial G equals K2 phi A, we must show that K2 is A1 invariant. So if you show that, then we get the desired quality. So yeah, that was really simple. And so at this point, I think I can formulate our main result. So the result says the following: that suppose that he is either of type A of rank at least 4, or it is of type D of rank at least 7, and 2 is invertible. Then this K2 is A1 invariant, and in particular, all our previous discussion implies that this pi1 can be computed like this. So I've put a vertical dash here. So by this, I mean the following, that I believe that with our technique, we can also prove the result for the exceptional groups and for D of rank at least 5 without the assumption that 2 is invertible. So all this can be summarized as phi simply less than contains A4. But for the second part, we probably need a better Horrocks theorem than we currently have. We have some work in this direction. So some work has already been done, and it looks promising that we can prove a theorem in this generality. But at the moment, we only have this computation, which is called stage one. Okay. And so this is the first part of the theorem. The second part is what I've called an analogue of Gersten conjecture, namely that these unstable K2 groups that over semi-local domains, they embed into these K2 groups over the field of fractions. Of course, for these groups, you have Matsumoto's theorem. So in particular, we have that these K2 groups, they embed either into, well, they embed into Milner K2. Okay, is everything clear so far? Probably someone has any more questions. Okay, if not, then I'll present another theorem of our paper. So what is this thing? So it is a general criterion for a functor to be A1 invariant. So it's at least in its statement, it now uses the fact that we are computing with the functor K2. So it also works for the functor K1 and possibly the specialists which are here can also make use of this theorem for other functors. So this is a sufficient condition for functor to be A1 invariant. So we, at the moment, we can make use of it in the case when this functor K is K, unstable K2. But probably anyone here knows some other examples. So what's the statement? So suppose that we have a field and an arbitrary group valued functor. And so suppose that this functor satisfies the following five axioms. Axiom one, that it commutes with filtered collimates. Axiom two is the following. So suppose that we have a Milner square like this. So what is this thing? In terms of schemes, it is we take a K algebra AR, consider its spectrum, and take a principal open subset of it, then consider A1 over it over this principal affine subset, and then we consider its push out. So in the category of rings, this push out, its coordinate ring is this semi-direct product of rings. So this can be interpreted as the polynomial rings. And all the coefficients of terms except the constant term are localized in A, but there are no denominators in the constant term. And so what we demand from functor K is that, so it is a pullback square, yes? And so we demand that the map on the kernels of vertical arrows, of these two vertical arrows, that there is an injection on these kernels. So is it clear so far? So the next axiom, this is what Ashok, Ayua, and Vent call weak affine Nisnevich excision. But in this theorem, we require it only for domains. So what does this mean? It means that if we have an inclusion of domains contained in this category of K algebras, such that the corresponding morphism on spectra of these two rings is an Natal morphism, and in addition, there is some element in B such that B modulo H is the same thing as A modulo the image of H. So this is called a distinguished, elementary distinguished Nisnevich square. So the dual to the square is an elementary distinguished Nisnevich square in the sense of Maravilovsky's old paper. So we require that if you apply functor K to this square, then this time on the kernels, you get a surjection. So that you get only a surjection and not, for example, an isomorphism, this this is why it is called weak. For the other words, I suppose that everyone understands why it's called affine Nisnevich. Okay, so axiom four says that if we have a local domain, then if you consider this square where we have two copies of the polynomial ring and Laurent polynomial ring, and there will be a smash between them. So we require that this square is pullback square. And the final axiom, A5, says that the functor k doesn't change when passing to the polynomial ring for fields. So that for fields, we have A1 invariance. And so under all these assumptions, we claim that the functor k is A1 invariant on any geometrically regular field over k. And we also have this analog of Gersten conjecture, namely that for a semi-local ring A, it embeds into K over its field of fractions. So are there any questions? So it, in some sense, this theorem is similar to the result of Ashoku, Yu, and Wendt, and Kalyotalena and Guren. At least some of the axioms look similar. For example, this axiom A1. But nevertheless, it is still different. So. Are there any questions? Probably anyone understands how this theorem can be applied to some other functor, not K1 or K2.
I'm going to say anything about the proof.
Yes, I'm going to actually present the proof with this evening. Yeah, so that was the goal. So for the rest of the talk, I'm going to explain how to prove this theorem.
Why do you need, I mean, the fourth axiom looks a little bit different from the others.
So say it again.
The fourth, I mean, this acyclicity axiom is slightly different from the others in some sense.
I demand it only for a local domain, you mean?
No, I mean, this diagram somehow.
That it is a folder. So, yeah, but.
In some sense, this diagram lives not in the category, I mean, not in the affine category, but in some, I mean, it is something about P1, something like that.
Yes, probably. But that's how our proof goes. So, I have no proper explanation for this, but that's just how I can show you where it is used in the proof.
Okay.
But by the way, I would like to say that when it comes to functor K2, verifying that it is an acyclic functor in this sense of axiom A4, is actually the hardest. Proof of all. So the other axioms are easy to verify than this A4. So for example, in the case D, it's a separate paper verifying that for spinor groups and the corresponding spinor K2, the spinor K2 has this property. So it is actually the hardest part. Okay. Anyway, so
maybe also one question. Without the last axiom, could be something deduced like such a square for corner being projective line. So assume that we don't know A1 invariance, but we have other axiom.
Yeah.
Will it give us some information, something like, there exists a square like in A4 for projective line over R. The problem is that you haven't defined the functor on the projective line, but So it is not a formal question, but just to, how much strong as assumptions without Evan invariance could these conditions be? Do you think apply to study non Evan invariant functors?
So I would not call this A1 invariance. I would call this A1 invariance for fields.
Yes, I understand.
Yeah. I probably have thought about this, but I forgot the answer. Probably these axioms are satisfied by standard group functor, all of them except the A5. So if you ask me whether this axiom follows from the others, then probably no, it doesn't, just because because standard group functor satisfies all this axiom except the last one.
No, I raise a thought. How much this method would say about non A1 invariant functors? So if the last axiom is just not true, but nevertheless, is it reasonable to?
I think it is reasonable. So I can answer you the following: that if there is only one point in the proof where you actually use the last axiom. So not used until the very end of the proof. So there will be a lot of statements which do not depend on the last axiom. So it will be used only in the very end. So I'm going. I will formulate a lot of things. Which follow from the axioms A1 up to A4. There will be five or six various statements about such case. They will appear shortly. Okay, so my goal is until the end of the talk is to attempt to present the proof of this fact, probably. At least a sketch of this proof. Okay. So, by the way, do we want to make a short break? Because an hour has already passed. Okay, if you don't, then I can continue. Okay. So the first step on the proof is to verify that if a functor satisfies the first two axioms, I mean these two, this commutative filter collimates and behaves good with respect to this particular family of Milner squares. That if it satisfies these two axioms, that it satisfies what is called Quillen-Suslin local global principle. So what is this Quillen-Suslin local global principle? You can formulate it as follows. So at least for a group valued functor. So let us define another functor called NK. So this will be some functor which measures the defect for K to be A1 invariant. So it is just by definition the kernel of the evaluation map to zero from RT to R. And of course, KRT, it decomposes into the semi-direct product just because KR, it injects back into KRT. And so, because we're dealing with non-commutative groups, it only gives us this semi-direct product decomposition. And so the definition for K to satisfy Quillen and Suslin local global principle is the following. So that NK embeds into the infinite product of NK over RM, where M varies over the maximal ideals of R. And it agrees with all of the classical results on where you see this term Quillen Suslin local global principle. Okay. So how do we prove that? The so the proof, there are several steps in the proof. So the first step is to verify that if an element of NKR, so keep in mind that an element of NKR is just an element of KRT. So it, if it maps to zero in NKRA, then for some large power of A, this evaluation map, which substitutes instead of T this expression, so it annihilates this element G. So we have this inequality in KRT. Why it is true? Well, just because this ring, this semi-direct product, can be interpreted as the collimit of polynomial rings, and the homomorphism between these rings are just substitution which evaluate T in AT. And then we just use the fact, so you use the axiom A2, so that if an element here trivializes when passing to this localized polynomial ring, then it has been trivial already of this arrow is injected. And then we just use the axiom A1, which says that K commutes with filtered collimates, and we are done. So this is the first step. So the next step is to deduce from this using the very standard techniques that for a pair of coprime elements of ring R and KR embeds into this product of NKs. So the technique is completely standard and probably has been invented back in 70s by Sinchuk. So, well, the idea is to write some very special polynomial so suppose that G is an element of this group which goes to the trivial element here. So there's a misprint here. Probably it should be so it should be K lambda A, K lambda B. Then we can see the another element. Which looks like this, and from the fact that it is annihilated by K lambda A, we use the first step of the proof and obtain the following quality. We repeat the same thing for B, and we get yet another quality in K as T2. And use the fact that so invoke the assumption that A and B were coprime. So then substitute into this formula certain specific values of T1, simplify this and get that in KRT there is this equality. So this means that G was trivial from the start. And then this implies that this error was injective. So probably not possible to follow, but this is a very old argument, actually a very standard one. And so the third part is to deduce from part B that actually this arrow is injective. So we just take an element from the kernel of this arrow, then consider a certain set, which is called, so it is called Quillen ideal of an element. The term is also standard in the literature. So we verify that it is actually an ideal. And it is very simple, so completely standard. I don't know if I should go into the details. So using the previous part, we verify that it is an ideal, and so if it is a proper ideal, that then it is contained in some maximal ideal. By our choice of G, so it should vanish when we map it. So under localization at N, so it vanishes just because it is chosen like that. But this contradicts the definition of the Quillen ideal. So we've got a contradiction. So this means that this ideal cannot be proper and it always coincides with R, all of R. Okay. So that's all proof. So we were able to show so far that just these two axioms, they imply that K satisfies Quillen's Wiesner local global principle. And we are going to use it a couple of times in our proof. So any questions? Okay, if not, so then we come to step two. So step two is that we want to globalize this acyclicity. This acyclicity axiom, which is also called Horrocks theorem. We want to generalize it from local domains to arbitrary domains. So how do we do that? So the argument is also very standard. So we fix a pair of elements GH, which map to the same element in K over Laurent polynomials. Then we, using the fact that we deal with groups, so we just slash the evaluated at zero part of these groups. So we can evaluate this element of K at zero and then just embed it back because K is functorial. If we have this equality, then of course we also have such equality in the localized version of R. So I also have a misprint here. I mean not T1, T2, but T1. T minus one. Or I have a white marker, so I can actually erase all the misprints. Okay, and but for the local ring, we have already our acyclicity axiom. So this means, so this acyclicity axiom states that this element comes from K of Rm. Since we have slashed the zero of component, this means that it's actually trivial. So we have just shown that lambda m of g prime is trivial. Then we can invoke local global principle and claim that this g prime was trivial from the start. And this in particular means that these two elements, they come from kr. And that's what the acyclicity axiom actually states. Okay. So of course we get by symmetry the same thing for H, and of course they must coincide just because KR it must embed into KR T minus one for obvious reason, just because there's a lot of splittings. You can evaluate this polynomial at anything but zero and infinity. And so this implies that this map is injective. And so of course they must coincide. Well, that's it. So that was the proof of step two, and namely we have just globalized globalized this axiom before. Okay. So here comes step three. It is called the main corollary of P1-Bluin. So it says the following, that if you have an arbitrary domain containing a field K and have a monic polynomial, then this localization homomorphism induces an injection on these groups. So the proof goes like goes as follows. So we take our monic polynomial, so its coefficient before the lead monomial is one. So we can just divide it modulo T1, and we get this polynomial. So notice that if we evaluate it at infinity, we get one, by the way. So it will be important later. But now we see that these two, so localizer F and localizer G, is the same thing if at least for Laurent polynomial ring is the same if you localize F or G, just because they differ by an invertible element of this ring. So then we consider the following diagram. So here are our two copies of polynomial rings. In the center, we have our Laurent polynomial rings, and vertical arrows are principal localization homomorphisms. So notice that the right square is an elementary distinguished Zariski square. In particular, it is an elementary distinguished Misnevich square. And so what do we attempt to prove? So we attempt to prove that if we apply K to this diagram, so that the left vertical map is injective. So suppose that we have an element in such a kernel. And then of course this element lies in the kernel of the central arrow. But since we have our weak affine Misnevich excision, in particular weak affine Zariski excision, so this element actually comes from some element from the kernel of K applied to this vertical arrow, in such a way that these two elements that they agree, so they map to the same element of K of this thing. And so then we can invoke our acyclicity theorem and obtain that there both x and y, so thing here and here, comes from some z of kr. But since so at this point they invoke the assumption that f is monic, but not, so notice that this guarantees that so we can of course embed R into the localized polynomial ring, but for this ring we have the homomorphism of evaluation at infinity. So just because if we evaluate the polynomial G at the infinity, we get one every time. So in particular, this composite homomorphism, this is how to say, so what here is a retraction, what is a splitting? So I would say that this invariance splits, yes, and for functoriality reasons, this implies that this kr embeds into krt minus 1g, and if it goes to zero, then it should have been zero from the start in particular. So we obtain that all these things x, y, and z and z are all trivial from the start. So that's it. So here is our step three. Any questions? Okay, so now comes step four, and here we invoke a recent theorem of Panin. I mean, theorem 2.25 from his paper, Nice Titles. So let us recall the statement of this theorem. So suppose that we are given a smooth domain over a field, a bunch of maximal ideals of it, and let A be the semi-localization of R in this set of maximal ideals. So by definition, this is this thing. And suppose that we have a polynomial, well, not a polynomial, but an element of R which vanishes in all of these maximal ideals. So then Panin's theorem says that there is a monic polynomial H. Probably it is not written, but should have been written. So it should be monic. Let me write that. So H is monic. There is an essentially a smooth domain over K such that this square, I mean, this left square is a distinguished Nisnevich square. So by the way, in his paper, Panin actually writes a diagram like this, namely the dual version of it. So in particular, distinguished Nisnevich means that this homomorphism T is a tile. Actually, his theorem states a little bit more. There are some other conditions on this diagram which we are not using, actually. So it is a stronger result than what I've just stated. Nevertheless, so what do we notice immediately? So we notice immediately that this homomorphism T, tau, that it is an injective homomorphism for obvious reason, just because we deal with domains. So since this homomorphism is a tile, so it is open. This means that its image is non-empty and open and is contained in the zero set of the kernel of tau. So this implies that I is radical, and since A was a domain, so it is zero. So this is the first thing to notice. The second thing to notice is that actually we have this isomorphism, that the quotient of AT modulo H is the same thing as quotient of S modulo the image of H under tau. So this is because this is an elementary distinguished Nisnevich square. Why? Just because Morel Voivodsky's definition of what is a distinguished Nisnevich square, it says that there should be an isomorphism if we put radicals on here. But using topological invariance, it is actually not hard to show that actually there is the isomorphism on the null, so you don't need to put radicals into these formulas. So probably any question?
Okay. Is it only one place in the reasoning where you use that the base ring is a field?
A good question. It can be so, actually. Yeah, so it is quite plausible that this is the only place where it is used. Probably you haven't used it already. I mean, we haven't used it before. Okay, why did we bother with verifying this stuff? Well, just because we want to be able to apply our axiom, weaker fine Nisnevich excision for domains, and here we have explicitly stated that this arrow is an injective homomorphism, and we have isomorphism like that. So the isomorphism on the nulls without any radicals. Okay, so how do we use this theorem? So the corollary to this theorem is the following, that if K are A and M are as above, then this homomorphism of groups is injective. So to shorten our notation, we rename this fraction fraction field of A to E, and we also introduce the special notation for the multivariate polynomial ring over K. We just replace it to B, so that we can write, instead of A x1 xn, we can write A times B over K. Okay, so we want to show that this element of this kernel is trivial. So we want to lift it to an element of K R times B, but so there is no a priori reason why K R to K A is surjective. So, but using our assumption that K commutes with filtered collimates, we can at least lift it to an element of K RF, where F RF prime, where F prime is a certain element of this multiplicative set in which we localize R. So probably not everybody can follow. So let me repeat once again. So we take a ring R, and A is its semi-localization. So it is localization of R in this multiplicative subset. So we take an element of this kernel. So it's in particular an element of this group. And so since K commutes with filtered collimates, and this thing is a filtered collimate of principal localizations of R at polynomials from this multiplicative subset times tensor times B, there exists some F prime such that G comes from some element G1, which lies here, comes under the localization in maximal ideals M1 prime, MK prime, where MI prime is just extension of scalars for MI. And it is easy to see that each of these maximal ideals is still a maximal ideal, just because we have localized at an element which doesn't vanish in either of those maximal ideals. Okay. And so for shortness, we rename this localized ring RF prime to R prime. Let me write that, because I don't see it written. Oh, no, now it is written. So we have just renamed this principal localization of R at F prime, which is just renamed it to R prime. Okay. So, and of course, if it vanishes in this ring, then there is some element of it which localization at which already annihilates this element. So this F exists just because G lies in this kernel. And without loss of generality, we may assume that this F actually zeros at every maximal ideal. Just because if it doesn't, we can multiply it by something, and this element will still be trivial. Any questions? So this is all standard. Okay, so if there are no questions, so what do we do next? We just take this diagram as in Panin's paper, but we replace R with R prime. So we have to tweak a little bit the ring that we've started with. So we replace it with R prime, with this principal localization. so we then obtain the following diagram. So this is the diagram like on the previous page, but with R replaced with R prime. And so and the localized ideal also replaced by the corresponding extensions of scalars. Okay, so what do we have? So we have that our element G, which lies in the kernel, that it comes from some element G1, which is annihilated by this homomorphism. So that's how we have chosen our elements F and F prime. Yes, so we have this part of the diagram. Then, of course, we can map it to the left, send it to the left, we get an element KPG1, which of course also goes to the trivial element here. And then we invoke our recurfine Nisnevich excision. So which says that if we have an element here, that it can be lifted to some element G2. So yeah, so we invoke our recurfine Nisnevich excision. So there exists G2 such that we have this diagram. And so it remains to see that this old diagram is commutative, but let me actually mention an important thing about this diagram is namely that this composite homomorphism tau delta coincides with the evaluation homomorphism at zero. And this shows that our element G with which we have started with coincides with the image of G2 under the evaluation homomorphism at zero. And since it is trivial, by the way, why it is trivial? So it is trivial by the previous step, by step three. So using step three, we were able to show that principal localization doesn't kill at a monic polynomial, which is important. So that it doesn't kill anything in the corresponding group K of these two rings. So remember that H is a monic polynomial in T. And so by step three, we have that this homomorphism is injective. And as I've said, G is the image under the homomorphism of used by the evaluation at zero of this element G2, which is trivial. So therefore G is trivial and we obtain our sort of injectivity. So we get our statement. So yeah, we have shown that. So, and finally, so we can finish the proof of the theorem. And after that, I'll say a couple of words of how difficult it is to verify either of these axioms for the functor K2. So the proof goes as follows. So suppose that, by assumption, we have that I is a geometrically regular ring. By Popescu's theorem, it is a filtered collimator of smooth algebras. So we notice that NK also commutes with filtered collimates. So our goal is to show that NK vanishes for every geometrically regular ring over K. So it is enough to show that it vanishes for smooth algebras. And actually by the local global principle, step one, it is enough to show that NK vanishes for over these local rings. That's M is every maximal ideal of R. We also can assume without loss of generality that R is a smooth domain because the only problem for it to be a domain is that it can be a not irreducible, but these rings, they would be the same. So we can safely assume that I was a domain. And so here's the only point in the proof where we actually invoke our A1 invariance for fields. So what do we have? We have that the horizontal arrows of this diagram, they're injective. So this is what we have already deduced from Panin's theorem. Actually, here we, the statement was for an arbitrary number of polynomials, but for example, but it works, for example, for m equal to 0 and 1. So the statement is already non-trivial for 0 polynomial variables. And so we invoke this result. We attend that these horizontal arrows are injective by the previous step. And by our last axiom, homotopy invariance for fields, this homomorphism is an isomorphism. And so this implies that the left arrow is injective. So this we get that NK is trivial for RM, and all these arguments implies it is trivial for in the general case. Okay, so this is the first claim of the of our theorem. So the second claim is an analogue of Gersten's conjecture. Well, so the proof goes like this. So again, we present our geometric irregular domain as a filtered collimates of smooth domains. Lift an element of this kernel to an element of KR for some smooth K domain. And so then we can see the preimages of the maximal ideals of A. There is only a finite amount of these maximal ideals because it is semi-local. And then at every preimage, we fix, so we can see the maximal ideal MI, which contains the preimage of all these maximal ideals. And so we get the following diagram. So the canonical map from R to A, so it goes through these localizations. But by step four, if an element from here vanishes vanishes in the fraction field, then it is not trivial already here. So then it is trivial here. And we have lifted an element of Ka to an element of Kr, but by the previous step, we have that it vanishes in this semi-localization. Well, that means that its image in A already has been trivial. And so we get that this G is trivial. Okay. And so we are done. So we have verified this theorem, and probably in the last couple of minutes, I'm going to.
Oh, may I just ask to explain one point in step three again, existence of Y? Sorry.
Existence of what?
Of Y. Yes, this one.
Existence of Y. Well, this is just because X is an element here, yeah?
Yes.
And so the axiom weak affine Nisnevich excision says that we have surjection on kernels. So every element which maps goes to zero here comes from some element here.
Ah, okay, yes, thank you.
Okay. Okay, so that was all the proof. And so in the remaining couple of minutes, let me mention so what is the complexity of verifying all these axioms for the functor K2? So the fact that it commutes with filtered collimates is actually obvious. So just because it is defined as a finite limit, as a kernel of Steinberg group to Chevalley group, but notice that both the Steinberg group functor and both the Chevalley group functors, they both commute with filtered collinearities. Just because Steinberg group is defined in terms of a finite number of root subgroups, and just because the Chevalley group, it is represented by a finite dimension, by a finitely generated Hopf algebra. So this implies that both of these functors commute with filtered collinearities, and then K2 also commutes with them as a kernel. These two functors which do that. So axiom A5, namely the A1 invariance for fields, it is an old result, actually unpublished result of Wolf Riemann, but his preprint is available and everybody believes in it. So the axiom A2, namely the fact that we have local global principle, it has been verified by me and Andrei. So in this paper, for root systems of type IDE, for the symplectic games. In the symplectic case, I believe Andrei has established the result like this. And so what remains are two axioms, namely A3, namely weak affine Nisnevich excision, and A4. So as for A4, namely for the cyclicity, so in the linear case, it is an old result by Turing-Baev. And for the orthogonal case, it is our joint paper with Andrei in Documenta. And so the new result, which we are able to prove in our paper with Andrei and Egor, is that we can prove certain theorem from which we can find Nisnevich excision for K2 follows. So this is actually a new result, so it is new even for in the linear case. And so what we can prove is the following, that if we have this pullback square of Steinberg groups, then the situation is less than the statement of V3, then STFB surjects onto this pullback. And so in the proof of this result, we use the new technique of pro groups, which has been recently introduced by Egor Voronetsky. So the proof is also quite different from, for example, what you can find in Tulimbaev's paper. Tulimbaev shows, I would say, the risk here. We can find the risk, we find the risk excision, so not Nisnevich excision. So he didn't know about Nisnevich topology. And the technique with which he shows this excision is also different. So he uses the technique of another presentation. But in our paper, we use completely different technique, namely this pro groups introduced by Egor Voronetsky. But it is the way how we prove this theorem is a topic for a separate talk, which I'll probably also do, but at another seminar. Probably it's not because it's some very, I would say, so it is some advanced group theory. It's probably not the topic for this seminar. Okay, so that's all. Thank you for your attention.